بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. Okay, so I begin by offering my congratulations to you all on the birth anniversary of our beloved Prophet and Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. So I'm sure today will be the day of Milad, Miladun Nabi, and Wiladat of Imam Sadiq in your countries as well. So here we come to our fourth session in this course on the Divine Justice or Justice of God. Okay, so as I've been mentioning, that sometimes the questions and the topics are just, they are very easy to mention. So justice of God, you can just talk about it in few minutes, 5-10 minutes. You can give a simple description and then you can move forward. But if you want to go into the details of any topic, it takes time. So knowledge requires time, and this is a law which applies to every science and every field of knowledge. So same thing holds true for Islamic knowledge as well, that we need time. And really, these five sessions, I have tried to compress so much information, and if I really had time, I would spread this information across maybe like 10 sessions. Okay, so what I'm going to do today, like I have been doing in my previous sessions, is I'm going to do a very quick recap, 5 minutes of the things we have discussed so far. So at least we know that where do we stand right now, so, and then we'll carry forward. Okay, so the first item today we have is a quick recap of what we did in the last session or last sessions. You can look at it that way. Okay, so I'm going to slide number 3. Okay, so the most important thing we discussed in this course is the meaning of divine justice. So what does Allah's justice mean? Okay, so generally justice means that you are given what is your right. Okay, so what you deserve. Okay, so when it comes to our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are the two things that are our rights. Okay, so we don't have any independent rights over him. Okay, but we have these two rights. What are our rights? First thing, our needs. So things we need to survive in this world and to reach our purpose and our goal, all those needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to provide them. And this is one dimension or one side of his justice. The other side of his justice is that if I do good deeds through my free will, and if I take efforts in his path to get closer to him, he is going to respond to these efforts, and he is going to grant me those perfections, and he is going to reward me for my actions. Okay, so this is a very simple definition of divine justice. Okay, so this is what we discussed. Then there was one very important discussion that we had, that how does Allah's justice show itself in different forms. So we said that Allah's justice shows itself in this world and in the hereafter. In this world, it shows itself in two ways. One is direct justice, the other one is indirect justice. And what's the difference? Direct justice means that he has designed a just system in this world, a system which does these two things. Okay, so one thing is, the system is designed in a manner that it is going to provide for the needs of different creatures. Okay, so there is going to be rizq and sustenance for every being, every living being that exists. That's how Allah has designed his system. He's not going to leave anyone without rizq. And the other meaning of this is, okay, some people, okay, it seems that maybe the brother doesn't have, maybe you can check most people can hear me well, then I'll just continue, inshallah, hoping that the brother is able to hear me, inshallah. Okay, so this is one dimension of his justice in this world. Okay, but there is an important dimension of his justice in this world, which is the indirect justice, which means that a part of the justice in this world he wants us to implement. So we are his representatives to implement this justice. Okay, and he's not directly going to come and establish justice. No. Why? Because it's against his wisdom to do so. Why? Because he wants the human beings to develop this quality of justice through their free will and choice. Okay, and the justice in the hereafter is clear that there will be accounting and no soul will be wronged to the extent of an atom's weight, as the verse of the Holy Quran says. Okay, moving on, then we looked at different doubts. Okay, so we covered three doubts, but the two doubts which we covered in last sessions, these just two slides show the summary of what we mentioned. So one doubt was related to the man-made evil, people oppressing others, and the question was that why does Allah allow humans to oppress others? Okay, and the answer was, can be summarized in this manner, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to stop people from exercising their free will. Why? Because he has made them out of his wisdom with free will. And the human beings have to choose their path in this world. And they are free to choose. And there's no one going to stop them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to directly interfere and take away people's free will. Okay, but this does not mean that Allah is sitting up there, na'udhu billah, in the skies, and he's just saying that, oh, look at these disobeying servants of mine, they have gone out of control. No, he's completely in control, but he's not going to stop you directly. Rather, there are other ways in which there's going to be reaction to injustice. The first reaction is that he wants the other human beings to stop this injustice. Okay, so for example, this picture you see on the screen is from the occupied Palestine, which has been under oppression for close to 70 years. Okay, so what is Allah's reaction to all of this oppression in this place and in other places? First reaction is that he wants other human beings to come and stop this oppression, do something. Okay. And the other reaction is, which we discussed last time, that there is also a certain level of direct reaction, and in the hereafter, the oppressors will be taken to account for their actions. Okay. Then we discuss this question of natural calamities and defects that occur around us. Okay, I don't have time right now, so this slide summarizes what we discussed last time, so I'm not going to go through it because I have a lot to cover today. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to move on, and today I am going to cover answers to three questions. So you can see on the screen, okay, so there are three questions which I have already covered, which are marked in green, you can see on your screen. And those marked in red, inshallah, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are going to cover them today. Okay, so we have three questions to answer today. Okay, so let's take on the first question. So this is the, excuse me, this is the question. Okay, so let me just go back to my previous slide. Okay, I think. Okay, so the question is this, that when we compare different human beings around us, we see that there is a great difference in the opportunities they get to reach perfection. Okay, so you can see in the picture, right? So on one hand, you have people who are born in affluent families with a lot of money that this baby is chewing iPad. Okay, and on other hand, we have millions and millions of people around the world who hardly have anything to eat. Okay, so, and this is the situation of our world today. If you go on the internet and just search world poverty, you'll come to realize that how big this phenomena is, that how many people cannot afford even one meal a day. Okay, so the question, so this is one aspect. There are other ways in which you can see differences in opportunities. For example, some people are born in religious families. Some people are not born in religious families. Okay. Some people are born in Muslim families. Some people are not born in Muslim families. For example, they are born in Hindu families. They are born in Christian families, Jew families. Okay. So when you compare different human beings and their starting point, okay, when they are born, they start at different points. So the question is it not unfair? Was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not supposed to provide everyone equal opportunity to reach Him, to attain perfection? Okay, so this is a question that we need to answer, that why do we have these differences in opportunities? Does it not put Allah's justice and the question? Okay, so this is an important question that we want to answer today. Okay, so let me start here. Okay, and again, to answer these questions, I'm just referring back to those first two sessions we did. Okay, so I'm just going to use the principles and the points that were mentioned in those sessions to answer these questions. So the answers are already there. We just need to work out these answers. Okay, so I'm going to again answer this question in steps. Okay, so step one is that let's first come and make a distinction between man-made differences and natural differences. Okay, and you'll realize that a lot of these differences Okay, sorry, there's some technical problem. I think I'm back, or at least it shows that I'm back. So inshallah, I hope I'm back. Okay, so step one of this answer is that many of these differences that we see around us are man-made. Okay, so again, we come back to the same point, that indirect justice, that justice as the duty of humanity, duty of the human beings, we were supposed to remove these differences in opportunities that we see. We were supposed to build a society where the gap between the rich and the poor would not be to the extent that we see today. That even in countries which are known to be the most advanced, or they claim to be the most advanced countries in the world in different ways, the United States of America, for example, it's one of those countries where the income equality is at its highest. Not everyone gets the opportunity to benefit from material pleasures. Why? Because we have built this system, a system where profit is central. So everything runs around profit, and sometimes it reaches a stage where people and the human beings, they stop caring about others. They said, who cares? I have money, I have a good life, I don't give a damn. I don't care about others. I don't care what happens to others. I don't care what's going around in the world. Okay, again, apologize for the, sometimes it happens because internet connection and different things. Okay, so let's make this distinction very clear, that if you remove these man-made differences in opportunities, the differences in opportunities which the human beings have created through their own hands. They decided to live in this manner. They decided, a large majority of them, or a big portion, a big number of them, decided to make profit and material pleasures their everything. What happens? You see differences in opportunities. A large number of people, and these are statistics, you can confirm them through internet, and it's not something unknown as well. So like, it's very commonly known, you can go and check it up on the internet, that, and I'm just reducing the figure so no one doubts. So the reports say that more than 1 million people die in the African continent. Why? Is there any kind of a war or something happened? No, because they don't have food, out of hunger. Most of them, a big number of them, are children. Why? Because they're most vulnerable to hunger. Okay, so this difference in opportunities is man-made, and this is the place where the human beings were supposed to establish justice, where they haven't been able to do so. Okay, so this part again goes back to us, the human beings. Okay, so here Allah's justice is not under question. It's the how the human beings okay, it's for some reason it's disconnecting me and connecting me again. So just give me 1 minute, I'm just reconnecting my internet. It will just take 30 seconds. Okay, I'm back. Inshallah, I hope that it shouldn't repeat again. Okay. Okay, so differences in opportunities. So a part of it is man-made. Okay, so what's the solution? What do we do? The solution is simple. The human beings should change. They should fix these problems. Okay, and inshallah, one of the important things that we have in our teachings is that when the Imam of the time will come, this would be one of the things that he's going to implement and establish: justice, equal opportunities for everyone in every single corner of the world. And before his coming, we can establish justice in the small area of influence we have. So whatever we can do, we should be doing. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to live a life of justice. Okay, but still, so this is one part. So the other part is the natural differences. Okay, it's not always man-made differences. Okay, so yes, the gap between the rich and the poor, a great amount of it today is man-made, because we have designed a system, the world economy runs in a manner that it automatically creates this gap. The rich people become richer, the poor become poorer, and it's a phenomenon which has been going on. Okay, but there are other places where it's not man-made, like where you are born, it's not in your hands, which family you are born, what surroundings you are born. So what happens to that? Okay, so in order to understand that, I'm going to give you one example, and this is a famous example. Okay, so just look at the picture on the left side on the slide. Okay, so this is this famous experiment by Galileo. Okay, so Galileo is standing on the Leaning Tower of Pisa, okay, the famous structure. Okay, and he's conducting an experiment. What is this experiment? Okay, so he's carrying a heavy ball and a light ball. Okay, so you can see in the picture, and he's going to drop both of them from the same height. Okay, question I'm going to ask you is that, if you don't think too much about this, and I ask you this question: which of these two metal balls is going to reach the ground first? Maybe your first reaction would be the heavier one will reach first. Why? Because it's heavy. It's going to fall faster and it's going to reach before that lighter ball. But when Galileo conducted this experiment, he found out that no, in fact, both these balls, they reach the ground at the exact same time. Okay, which is surprising. So one of these metal balls is few kilos, like 4, 5, 10 kilos. You can imagine a heavy metal ball, and the other one is few hundred grams, like maybe 50 or 100 grams. But both of these are going to reach the ground at that exact same time. So the question is, how does that happen? Okay, so to answer this question in physics, and this was Galileo who discovered this for the first time, and he gave a logical explanation for this. He explained this. So what they say in physics is that, look, why do these metal balls fall on the ground? Why? Because the gravitational force of the earth is attracting them. Okay, so that's very simple. Okay, now the force with which the earth is attracting the heavy ball is more, and the force with which the earth is attracting the lighter ball is less. Why? Because gravitational force depends on the mass. So if you have a bigger mass, there's bigger force. If you have a smaller mass, lesser mass, there's lesser force. Okay, but the problem is that although the force which is being applied on these balls is different, they are going to go down at same speed. Why? The reason is because this heavier ball, because it's heavy, it requires more force to move that same amount of distance. Okay. Okay. In short, what happens is that, yes, it gets more force from the earth, but this more force is balanced out by the heaviness of its weight. So this is divided and cancelled out, and both reach the ground at the same time. Okay, you might ask this question, what this has to do with our question? Okay, so this is just an example. So imagine the force with which these metal balls are being attracted as the opportunities different human beings get. So different human beings get different opportunities. But with every opportunity comes a responsibility of that level. Okay, so if you have more opportunity, it's harder to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to work harder. Your responsibility is higher than a person who did not get that opportunity. His accounting will be very easy. So what happens is that difference in opportunity is balanced out by difference in responsibility. Fair enough. So in conclusion, everything balances out. Okay, and this is a very, very important principle, and I'm going to even mention the verse of the Quran that clearly points to this very important principle, that one shouldn't think that if someone gets more opportunities for perfection, then that's it, he's ahead of me. And people have these questions. Sometimes they compare themselves with others. They say, oh, look at that person. He was born in a religious family. His parents had money. He got everything he wanted. He had all the facilities. And look at me. I didn't have anything. I had to suffer so much. And this can lead to dejection and losing of hope. But if you remember this principle that no, he got more opportunity because of natural causes. The world is designed in a manner that different people are going to be born in different places, in different environments, in different families. And different things are going to happen to them. This is the natural consequences of how this world is designed. But in your spiritual progress, it does not matter. Why? Because it's balanced out by how much responsibility you have. So this is definite, that if a person, for example, if a child is born in the holy city of Qum, in the vicinity of Hadrat Masuma Salamullah Alaiha, in a religious family, his father and mother are both scholars, responsibility of such a person is extremely high. If he wants to progress spiritually, he really, really has to work hard. A small mistake he makes deliberately can affect him spiritually to a great extent. And on the contrary, if a person was born in a very difficult situation, in a family where the environment was not good, in a society where it was difficult to practice Islam, then even if you take a small step, you'll get more results. Okay. And where do I get this from? This from the verse of the Holy Quran, and this is a very interesting verse. Again, there are these some very important verses in the Quran that we need to remember and memorize, and some of these key verses, they should always be there in our minds. Okay, so this is Surah An-Najm, verse number 39 and 40. What does it say? Wa an laysa lil insani illa ma sa. That nothing belongs to man except what he strives for. This is very important. You are what you strive for. Okay. Where you started doesn't matter. If you got a bad start because of the environment and different reasons that were out of your control, it doesn't eventually matter. Why? Because it's going to be balanced out by the amount of efforts you take. So what really matters, what really belongs to you in the hereafter, is not these opportunities you have. After the human being leaves this world, all these material opportunities, they were tools, and you have to part from them. You have to leave them in this world, your money, your facilities, everything. Okay, what remains with you is what you have strived for, your amal, your efforts. And then the verse continues, it says, وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. And the human being will soon be shown his efforts, his endeavor. And this is what will happen in the hereafter. That in the hereafter, we will see our actions, will be shown the effects of our efforts. Okay, so this is the Quran, that eventually What matters is your efforts. Yes, there are differences in opportunities which are natural. The natural world is designed in this manner. But it doesn't stop anyone from getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let me ask you this question. Can you guarantee that if you were put in a better situation than you are right now, you would perform better, you would take more efforts? Can you guarantee that? Has anyone guaranteed that if you are born in Qom in a religious family, that's it, now you'll become, everyone will become Allama Tabatabai, everyone will become Ayatullah Bahjat, everyone will become, for example, Imam Khomeini? No. They became what they became through their efforts. Why? The answer is very simple. There are hundreds and thousands of people who are born in religious families every year in the holy city of Qom, but not all of them reach that very high level. So the question is, what's the difference? The answer is efforts. They took more efforts. They took spirituality seriously. They took religion seriously, and they reached the station they reached. So it doesn't matter where you are, what situation you are facing. What matters is your efforts. Okay, so this was a rather long answer. I wanted to keep it short, but okay, I took 20 minutes. Not bad. I have just two more questions to cover. Okay. So if you have any questions, keep typing them. Inshallah, today I'm trying my best to... Okay, so let me just quickly answer this question. The same thing holds true for people born in different faiths. Okay, so inshallah, more details about this question, that people born in different faiths like Hinduism or not born on the right path, what happens to them? So inshallah, this is one of the questions I'm going to cover in my last session, where I have a long discussion about good deeds of non-believers. Okay, but the portion which relates to our discussion here is that, again, it doesn't matter. Why? Because even if you are born in a Hindu family, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send you guidance through different channels. And what are those channels? I'll mention them in the next session. And to whatever extent guidance reached that person, and to whatever extent he took efforts to accept that guidance, his reward or his, he will be judged based on that. Okay, so this is a short answer. The answer is the same, that eventually it doesn't matter. Why? Because a person will be judged based on how much opportunity he had to take efforts and how well he performed in the places where he could take efforts. Okay, but the question remains, and I'll answer this in my next session, that what are those channels of guidance? Okay, so we shouldn't think that the guidance doesn't reach people. No, there are different channels Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to awaken people, to tell them that there is truth, go and find out. Okay, so it depends on how much efforts they take. Yes, this does not mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy that people are born into the wrong faith, people worship idols. No, he's not happy. And he wants everyone to be a Muslim. But let us say, because of different factors, still around the world, there are close to 1 billion people, 1,000 million people who are Hindus, who worship idols. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not happy with this situation. And in fact, he wants us, the Muslims, and us, the followers of the school of Ahlul Bayt, to go and spread Islam to others. But as long as the truth has not reached them in the complete manner, they will be judged based on how much guidance has reached them and how much efforts they take. So details to this answer, inshallah, I'll mention in my last session. Okay, so this was doubt number 4, that differences in opportunities. Summarizing this, a part of these differences come from the human beings. It's man-made. And if you go around, a lot of these differences we see, especially differences in material opportunities we see. Some people can afford the best of the education. Some people can't even go to a very simple and basic school. In terms of money, in terms of house, in terms of cars, in terms of different comforts we have, a lot of these differences are man-made. Yes, there are some differences which are natural. Why? Because the natural world is designed in a manner that these differences will occur. But these differences in opportunities are balanced out by differences in responsibilities, and no one can conclusively say that, no, if I was born in that situation, I would perform better. Who knows? Maybe if I was born in a better situation, I was born in the holy city of Qom and I had everything, maybe in that situation, I wouldn't take the amount of efforts that I'm taking right now. Why? Because right now I'm in difficulty. We never know what situation is best for us. Okay, so this is a rather long answer to this question, but I only have two doubts to cover, so inshallah we won't be short on time. Inshallah, I'm going to leave last 20 minutes for question and answers. So I'm going to finish my discussion, two discussions, it shouldn't take me more than 30 minutes, and last 20 minutes I'm going to keep for question and answers. Okay, I'm just going to take a short break. It's Adhan time here, it's Fajr. So inshallah, I'm going to just pray and come back, so you can take a break, maybe grab a cup of tea or coffee, or just think about the different things that have been mentioned so far. So I'll be back in a few minutes. Okay, you can even start typing questions if you have any questions. This is a good time to just think about the questions you have, and if you want, you can just start typing them. Inshallah, I'll try to answer the questions towards the end. Okay, there are some questions left from the last session, inshallah, which also I'm going to answer, inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Okay, so after the short break, we are going to continue our discussion, and I have two doubts or two questions to cover. Okay, so without wasting any time, let me first, so this has been how I have been doing it. So first I explain the doubt and question, and then we try to give answer in steps and look at it from different ways and different perspectives, so we have the complete answer. So the question is this, that tribulations, or as it's called in Arabic, bala, difficulties that the human beings face in their lives, okay, and sometimes these difficulties are really, really hard difficulties, okay, and they put emotional and psychological pressure on the human beings. People get questions, they say, why did this happen? Okay, so a tribulation comes, a bala comes, and it comes in different forms. Okay, it comes sometimes in the form of a disease, it comes in the form of losing someone who was very dear to you. Suddenly something happens and you lose someone who was very close to you. Okay, disease or loss of money. You are doing well, your family was doing well, suddenly something happens, now you are facing financial difficulties. Okay, something happens in your school, you are facing a certain kind of, okay, so, and this is through experience, right, that every human being knows that they face difficulties in this world. So they get this question, why these difficulties are there, why? And sometimes there's an added question, why only me? Why only bad things happen to me? Why only difficulties and tribulations and bala come in my life? So this, in a way, it's a question that goes back to divine justice. So it's like this, that this question, that why Allah puts these tribulations and bala? Because we know for sure that these events are not random and without any cause, that just things happen on random without any cause. No, we know that these bala and the difficulties, they are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so this is a separate discussion in itself. Inshallah, some other time we can discuss that, that these events that happen in our life around us, They are not random events. They have causes, but in most cases, we won't be able to figure out what was the exact cause. But we generally know that it has a cause, and these difficulties, and not only difficulties, on the other side of the difficulties, the blessings we have are also from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But blessings never provoke questions, right? Because blessings are good. No one is going to question, why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving us blessings? It's a good thing. So it's good for him to do that. But when it comes to tribulations and bala, people have questions. We all have questions. Okay, I had questions. So question is, why couldn't he just make everyone happy? Right? He could just make everyone happy. No bala, no difficulties. Okay? He could have designed a system in a manner that there are no difficulties. Answer. First thing that I'm going to mention is that I'm very sorry, sometimes we have wrong views about things. Okay, and wrong views about different things, they raise questions in our minds. Okay, so all of you know what a sauna is, right? Okay, I'm sure, I mean, you can see in the picture. So it's a room, okay, it's usually attached with the swimming pools. So it's a room which is hot. Okay, so if someone comes and asks, why is the sauna so hot, what would you answer? You'd answer that it is supposed to be hot. It's made so that it is hot, so that you go there, so that your muscles get relaxed, and it's a place designed to be hot. So if someone has the wrong view that sauna shouldn't be hot, then he's always going to have this question. He's always going to be in this mental pressure that why is the sauna hot? Okay. Another example. If someone comes and tells you, asks you this question, why do I have to study in the school? Because studying is difficult, right? We have to sit on your table, open your book. It takes effort. Sometimes you don't feel like studying. You have homework. It's difficult. So someone comes and asks you that, or you ask this question to yourself, why do I have to study in the school? Okay, the answer is simple, that everything requires a certain kind of a cause. Okay, so school is that place where you go to study. So either don't go to the school and you won't have to study, just leave the school. Okay, that's one option. But if you want to be in the school, you have to study. Why? So sometimes we have wrong view about different places. So sometimes we have some people, some young students, they have wrong view that school is a place for going and enjoying and having fun. Yes, you can have fun. But the main reason why you go to the school is to learn. And if you want to learn, you have to study. It's a natural consequences of going to the school. The same thing holds true for the dunya. Okay. This question that why do I have to face bala in this dunya is based on a wrong view that I'm not supposed to face any difficulties in this world. Okay, this is a wrong view. Who said that? Where did you bring this thing that in this dunya there shouldn't be any difficulties? No. In fact, in our Islamic teachings, we have that this is what dunya is. Okay, this is a piece from narration from Amirul Mumineen alayhi salam. So he says, describing this dunya, he says, Darun bil bala'i mahfufa. It's a place which is surrounded by bala and difficulties. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed this world. So, so if you want to be in this dunya, you will have bala. And this is a very important point that we all should know, that we shouldn't think that only I have difficulties. No, every single person in this world has to undergo difficulties. It's something which no one can avoid. The only problem is that I can see my bala and my difficulty, I can't see other people's difficulties. Why? Because I'm not with them all the time. So sometimes I think that, oh, look at that person, how happy he is, he has no difficulties, he's enjoying so much, and look at me, how, in what difficult situation I am, and I have so many problems. So you are just looking at the zahir. How much time have you spent with that person? Every person has his own difficulty. The difficulties can be different, but no human being can come in this world and not face difficulties and tribulations. Okay. Now the next question is, why do we have these bala? Okay, so okay, excuse me again, some problem in the internet. Okay, so now, so my first point was that in this dunya there is going to be bala. This dunya, this world is designed in a manner that there will be bala. Okay, now the question is why? Why has Allah designed this world in this manner? Okay, so let's quickly go through why do we have these bala. Okay, so I'm going to just mention them quickly in points. The first point to understand is that tribulations are not absolute evil. It's not that they have no goodness in it. Okay, yes, they are evil, they are bad, they affect me, they can affect me. Okay, a disease can affect me, it affects me physically, it can affect me spiritually. Okay, so there is evil in it, but we shouldn't think that it's absolute evil, there's no goodness in it. Okay, so this is first point. Second point, these bala are from Allah, who is wise, who is hakim, who has wisdom. Which means that there is a reason why these tribulations are there. And therefore, in this verse of the Holy Quran, Suratul Baqarah, verse number 216, and this again is one of those very important verses of the Quran. And indeed, all the verses of the Quran are extremely important. This verse is, وَأَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Yet it may be that you dislike something which is good for you. And this is what happens to the human beings. And this is what happens when tribulations come. We dislike tribulation. It's natural. to dislike tribulations, and we have to try our best to remove these difficulties. If you are sick, you go to the doctor. Okay. But as long as you are sick, don't think that this sickness or this disease is an absolute evil. No. Maybe it is something which you dislike, but there is khair and goodness in it. Okay. So why these tribulations are there? We're just going to go through it. Tribulations and difficulties are tests. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to test us. Okay. So like in the same manner that in your school, in your university, you have exam, which is a test, which is there to test you how much you have learned. Tribulations are there to check your faith. Why? Because it's easy to profess faith through tongue. I can come and say, yes, I believe. Okay, and inshallah, we all believe, we are all believers. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to check this and test this faith practically. Okay, and this is verse from Surah Al-Ankabut, verse number 2 and 3. I'm not going to read the Arabic. I'm just going to read the translation. Do the people suppose that they will be let off because they say we have faith and they will not be tested? This is a wrong conception. We shouldn't think that just verbal profession of faith is sufficient. No. Faith is shown in its reality and it is strengthened through action. And when we are put in a difficult situation, then is when our real metal is shown. What is really inside us comes out. So these are the tests to check, to test our iman, to strengthen our iman. So these tribulations are tests. Okay, so therefore they are good for me. Okay, and then I'm just going to expand on this one thing. Okay, these tests are very, very important. Why? Because they are there for these different reasons. Okay, so tribulations are a test, and tests are there for these three things. One, sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send a difficulty in your life to wake you up. It's a test. It's there to wake you up. I mean, if you are going on a highway and there are no these speed breakers, as you can see on the screen, what's going to happen is that after some time, now you're cruising at the speed of 120, 150. Okay, now these fast cars, they can go at... What is going to happen if there are no these speed breakers and these warning signs? After some time, you're just going to fall in negligence. You're just going to take things for granted and you might lose control and you might end up in an accident. So these tests are there to wake up us. Okay, and again, this is there in the verses of the Quran. For example, this verse in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 168. This is the portion which I'm intent is, and we tested them with good and bad so that they may come back, so that they wake up, they come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and these, okay, and this is an interesting point in this verse of the Quran, that sometime Allah tests us with good things. He gives us a ni'mat, a blessing, and through this blessing He wants us to turn back to Him, to remember Him, to wake up from this sleep of negligence. And sometimes He tests you with a difficulty, a bad thing, but the goal is the same. He wants to wake you up. I'm drowning in negligence. I'm forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my life. I need someone to come and shake me. Okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to do this through difficulties. Okay, so it's good for me. I mean, yes, I'll face difficulty for that period, but it's going to wake me up. It's going to bring me closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. The second reason why we have tests is tests are there to make us strong and give us higher perfections. Why? Because some of the perfections can be acquired through facing difficulties. Let me just give you one example. And that example is the quality of patience. Okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to inculcate this quality of patience in you, in the human beings. How do you do that? Okay, one of the ways is to put a person in difficulty, and then in that difficulty you remain patient You resist that difficulty, and in this manner you acquire sabr. You get different perfections. And this is a very, very beautiful and important verse from the Holy Quran. Again, I don't have time to read the Arabic. I really love to recite the Arabic of the Quran, but I don't have time. So I'm just going to read the translation again, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 155 to 157, and see. It uses the word test. We will surely test you with a measure. Okay, measure means a little bit. So we will surely test you with a little bit of fear, hunger, loss of wealth, lives and fruits. Fruits means material gains, farming, cattle and other things. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and give good news to the patient. So there is a good news for people who remain patient. Okay. Who are these patient people? Those who, when an affliction visits them, when they face a difficulty, they remember Allah. They say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Okay, so this famous thing which we know comes from this verse of the Quran. That they say, indeed we belong to Allah and to Him do we indeed return. So this difficulty makes them remember Allah. They are patient. And now see what Allah says about these people who are patient in face of difficulties. It is they who receive blessings from their Lord and His mercy. And it is they who are the rightly guided. So one of the ways of giving you higher perfections, higher guidance, taking you a step further, taking you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the ways is by putting you through difficulties, yes. In face of difficulties, we have to act in the right manner, which we need to learn. So if we act in the right manner in the face of difficulties, it brings spiritual perfection. And the last reason we have tests are, they are there to purify us from our sins. Okay, so this is also one of the reasons that we have these difficulties. Okay, and if you see, yes, it's difficult, but it's better than suffering for effects of my sins in the hereafter. Okay, so it's like this. So he's going to put a difficulty in your life, and he's going to, because you suffered in this world, he's going to wipe out your sins. Okay, that's good, right? Because the difficulties of this world, they pass away. They end. Okay, it's a difficulty for a short period. And even if it looks like a long period, it's eventually going to end. So if you face difficulty, if we face difficulty, we should remember that it is because of one of these three reasons. Either Allah wants to wake me up, or He wants to give me higher perfections, or He wants to purify me. All these three things are good for me. Okay, and therefore these tribulations are there. So therefore you have in one of the narrations, so this thing you see on your right side is a summary of a narration that we have from Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam, and coincidentally today being his birth anniversary, and we let us all recite a salawat for our sixth Imam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So he says that tribulations has these three functions. Okay, for oppressors it is a means of correction. Okay, for oppressor, it means those who have oppressed their nafs, who have committed sins. So, it's a way through which their sins are wiped out and they are waken up. Okay, so for those people who have oppressed their souls, they have committed sins, it's a means of correction. He puts you in a difficulty to wake you up, to bring you back to the right path, to wipe your sins. For a believer, it is a test. Okay, so it is a test. Okay, and it can mean different things. It can have different functions. It's maybe to make you stronger. It's maybe to wipe your sins. And for the awliya, for people who are the close servants of Allah, they also have tests. The anbiya and the ma'asumeen, the imams, they have tests. In fact, they have the most difficult tribulations and tests. Okay, the question comes, why do they have tests? Imam Sadiq explains, it is a means through which their stations near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are increased. Okay, so some of the stations and some of the perfections, very high perfections, which belong to the ma'asumeen and the anbiya, these very close servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they undergo difficulties in their material world, and this is a means through which they become more close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They get those higher stations near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you look at it from this angle, again, this is a very, very important point, that we should look at different things that happen in our life positively. Okay, so sometimes what happens, and it's natural for the human beings, that sometimes the negative side overtakes us. And it's natural, it happens to me also. For example, I am facing a difficulty, and in that situation, I can't think positive. I'm just looking at the negative side of this difficulty. Oh, how difficult it is, when will it solve? Yes, I have to try and solve these difficulties. See, Islam doesn't say that if you are in a difficulty, you just leave it. No, you go and solve it. But as long as you are facing this difficulty, look at the brighter side. Look at the positive side. Look at the benefits it's having for you. Your sins are being forgiven. You're becoming stronger. It's a wake-up call for you. So we should always have this positive outlook towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and towards His system. Okay. Again, I'm going out of my time. Inshallah, I'm trying to cover my last question. And sometimes I fear that I'm over explaining. So if sometimes you see that if I'm over explaining something, just type in the chat, the place where you can chat, that okay, it's clear, we don't need so much explanation. Sometimes I go into this phase that I'm over explaining something. Okay, so let me come to my last doubt. I don't have much time. Okay, so this doubt relates to the evil in the hereafter. Okay, so the doubts before that, they're related to different things. Okay, so we have one question about tests, which I'll answer in the end. It's a very good question. Okay, so the question here is that eternal punishment. So this is to do with the hereafter. Okay, so from now onwards, so for a few minutes of this session and our next session, we are only going to discuss questions related to the hereafter. Okay, so this is one of those questions, that eternal punishment, is it not too much? Okay, so how can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish someone eternally? Isn't that evil? Okay, someone sinned for, let's say, 70 years of his life. Okay, and then in the hereafter, he's punished eternally. Okay, how do we know this? We know this from the Holy Quran, that there will be a group of people who will face eternal punishment. It doesn't say that every single person who was not on the right path will face eternal punishment. And some of the details I'll discuss tomorrow when I'm discussing good deeds of non-believers and what happens to their hereafter. But this we know conclusively, that there will be some people, okay, we don't know who they are, how many they are. Maybe in our narrations, the Ahlul Bayt have mentioned some names for whom eternal punishment has been promised. But from the Holy Quran, we know this. Why? Because in many places, I think more than 10 places, it says there will be a group of people who will stay in Jahannam khalideena fiha abada. They'll stay in there forever. Okay. So, how do we understand that? What does it mean? Okay. So again, I'm going to try and answer this question in steps. Okay. And I'm going to take maximum 10 minutes to answer this question. I'll have to rush a bit, but I have no choice because I want to leave at least 15 minutes to answer the questions. Because for me, answering these questions is more important than covering new things. Okay. So let me do it step by step. First thing is, let's understand the system of cause and effects correctly. Okay, so we know that the entire universe runs on the system of cause and effect. Every effect has a cause. Different causes lead to different effects. Okay, but there is one very interesting thing to note here, that effects are in proportion to its cause. Okay, so for example, you see this picture here, something has gone wrong. Okay, so no, sorry, why do you see that this stone is balanced while you have one stone on one side, you have four stones on the other side? The answer is simple. Why? Because their weight is same. Okay, so small causes have small effects, big causes have big effects. Okay, it's very common sense. Okay, I'm not saying something new. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that there is some kind of a proportional relationship between cause and effect. Small causes lead to small effects, big causes lead to big effects. Okay, so this is something very simple. But the problem sometimes we face is that sometimes we look at the zahir of the cause, and when we look at the zahir of this cause, it looks very small. But when you see the effect it produces, you are surprised that how comes this small thing produce such a big effect. Okay, let me give you one simple example, and just an example. So imagine this piece of pepper, how small it is. It's very small, right? If you look at the zahir of this pepper, this red chili, it's very insignificant. It's very small. But you know the effect it can create. If you take this and put it in your mouth and start chewing it, you might end up in the hospital. Okay? You might need medical care for that. Why? Because apparently and in the zahir, this cause looks small. But in reality, it is a big cause. Okay, so what's the problem? The problem is that sometimes we judge things through our eyes, through what we see by zahir. We see that, oh, this pepper, this chili is so small. How much harm can it do? You don't know how much harm can it do. It can take you to the hospital if it's a really, really hot chili, or it's at least going to force you to remain uncomfortable for at least some time, 10 minutes. Okay. So, what I'm trying to say that even though our actions in this world are small, human being is such a thing that his actions have eternal effects. Okay. And this is how, this is what a reality is. Sometimes we judge the human being, we judge ourselves by our zahir. We say, oh, this human being, this maximum weighs, like generally the average weight is less than 100 kgs, the average height is like 5 feet 6 inches, this small human being, insignificant in its zahir. Yes, but you are just looking at the zahir. He has a soul. That soul is eternal, and actions can have eternal effects. Okay, so in order to explain this, that how much difference is there in dunya and akhirat, the scholars give example of difference between womb of the mother and this dunya. Okay, so if you compare womb of the mother, so when the child is in the womb of the mother, the entire world and universe for that child is this womb. Okay, and when he comes to this dunya, he's like, oh wow, look at this dunya, how extensive it is, how big it is. So in the same manner, where as long as we are in this dunya, we think that everything is limited to this realm. No, when we'll go in the hereafter, we'll realize that this dunya is even more insignificant than a womb when you would compare it with the dunya. So the realm of the hereafter, the akhirah, is okay. So these are some of the characteristics of the realm of the akhirah. So in the hereafter, there will be only accounting and hisab. It's not a place for actions. This world is where you act, and each single action has an effect on your soul. Okay, and your soul is eternal. It's infinite. There's no limit to it. It's timeless. Okay, and this eternal potential and this eternal dimension of your existence will show in the hereafter. Why? Because in this world, because of the limitations it has, it cannot show infinite things. It's limited. Okay, but in the hereafter, there's no limit in the realm of hereafter. It has infinite potential. Okay, and the third important point to know about is that our reward and our punishment is not something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to impose us on outside. Okay, it's not like what happens in this world, that a person steals, then the police catches him and now he's punished for his actions. So that his action and his punishment are two different things. No. In the hereafter, your reward and your punishment is the batin of that action itself you perform in this world. Okay, so our actions can have infinite consequences. Yes, the cause looks small, but in reality it is big. Yeah. But we generally know that eternal punishment is for those, it's not for everyone. Okay, again, this again is there from the Holy Quran. Okay, so who it is for? See, the formula is very complicated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only knows that who are these people in the Ahlul Bayt, know who are these people who will face eternal punishment. But we generally know that those people who deliberately sin, who do not repent, they commit sins of great magnitude, they kill and oppress thousands and thousands of people, they deviate people, they take people away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and maybe, okay, the human soul reaches a stage where now it cannot return, it cannot change. Why? Because in this world, this person has disfigured it in a manner that now it can't change. And some of these pointers you can see in the Holy Quran, Surah Az-Zukhruf, verse number 50. So it's talking about a group of people. So this is very strange. So, فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُمُ الْعَذَابِ إِذَا هُمْ يَنْكُثُونَ. But when we lift the punishment from them, behold, they would break their pledge. They would go back. They would turn back. Maybe, therefore, the eternal punishment is for those people who have disfigured their soul eternally. Yes, we know that with one or two sins, this doesn't happen. It requires that person sins a lot. He opposes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot. Yes, it doesn't happen if someone repents. Yes, it doesn't happen if the sin is not of a great magnitude. Okay? But it's a dangerous thing. Human beings should be careful. Okay, so what is our duty? What should I be doing? Okay, so I'm just going to summarize. Okay, so the first thing is that intellectually, or at least religiously, we should accept that eternal punishment is possible, and it is just because it is the result of that person's own actions. Okay, so intellectually also, my intellect tells me that if anyone is going to eternally disfigure his soul through his own actions, then it's eternally disfigured. Human being is infinite. There's no jokes about it. It's a very serious matter. Okay. So first duty is to accept that eternal punishment is possible. Second duty is that we should be careful of our own actions. Why? Because I don't know which of my actions and how dangerous it is. So that's one other thing. Third thing is that I should generally know what are those big sins, what are those very serious things which can possibly lead a person to eternal punishment, and some of the details are mentioned by the Ahlul Bayt. Okay, and the last duty is that when it comes to details, leave the matter to Allah and the Ahlul Bayt. Let us not give judgments either ways. Okay, so let us not say that, oh, this person will definitely, because he's not on the right path, this particular person is definitely going to suffer eternal punishment. No, stop. Don't make that judgment. Why? Because how do you know? Okay. And on the other side also, don't say this, that no, there's no such thing in Islam called eternal punishment. Oh, no, these verses of the Quran, they mean something else. No. So when it comes to details of these things, that who are those exact people who will face this situation? Okay, what exactly they have done? See, we shouldn't imagine that we have knowledge of everything. We generally know things, but when it comes to details, we should say that I don't know, and we leave the details to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Ahlul Bayt. And to prove this last point, that many times we don't know the details, I'm going to give you one very interesting example, and I'm going to finish with that. Okay, and that example is this. Okay, so we have this verse in the Holy Quran, Surah An-Nisa, verse number 93, that talks about punishment of murdering a believer deliberately. Okay, so pay careful attention. Okay, so this verse says, should anyone kill a believer intentionally? Okay, so pay attention to the words, kill a believer, a mu'min, intentionally. Okay, knowingly killing a believer. His requital shall be hell. His punishment is hellfire, to remain in it forever. Okay. So this is one of those verses of the Quran that promises eternal punishment for someone who murders a believer intentionally, kills him intentionally. Okay. Of course, let me add this here. If he kills a believer intentionally and till end of his life he doesn't repent. Of course, if he repents, then the sin is forgiven. And this is very clear from other verses of the Quran, that if someone repents, then his sin is forgiven, even if it's a big sin. Okay. So keep these conditions in mind. Kill a believer intentionally and this person does not repent. This verse of the Quran promises eternal hellfire for this person. Okay. So if I would just look at this verse of the Quran, what would I say? Okay, let me ask you this question. That, let us say, there is enmity between two believers. For some reason, some dispute or property and something. So a believer named A and believer named B, they have enmity with each other. They hate each other because of some reason. Okay, both are believers, both are mu'min. Okay. One of them goes and deliberately kills that other person. Out of this enmity and hatred he has for that person, muta'ammidan, intentionally he goes and he kills. He's not forced, he didn't kill him by mistake, he knows and he goes and kills him. Okay. So if it would be just me and this verse of the Quran, what would I say? Yes, this verse applies to this person and this person has been promised eternal hellfire if he doesn't repent. Okay. But let me show you something very interesting. And this is this narration from, again, it's from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. Okay, I'm just going to finish in 2 minutes and then I'll keep the 10 minutes for answering the questions. Okay, it's very strange narration. This is there in Usulul Kafi, one of our important books of narrations. And the sanad, the chain of narrations of this narration is also sahih. It's a sahih hadith. So it's one of those hadith which the scholars accept. So there's no question like, oh, it's a weak hadith, or we don't know if the imam said. No, it's a sahih hadith. Okay. So a person comes to Imam Sadiq and he asks him question about this verse of the Holy Quran. Okay. The same verse which I mentioned, killing a believer. Okay. And he says that there are two believers who they have a quarrel and a fight, and one of them kills the other person. Okay, the same example I gave. So they had a fight, they both are believers and they are not happy with each other, they end into a fight, and one of them hits the other person with sword and he kills him deliberately. So now this questioner is asking the imam that based on this verse of the Quran, this person should deserve eternal punishment. Okay, sorry, again, some problem. Okay, I'm just finishing in 1 minute. Okay, so see the answer of the imam. And this is what I'm trying to say, that sometimes we don't know the details. The Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam know the details. So the imam says that no, this is not that person which this verse is talking about. This verse is talking about something else. So this verse does not apply to this example which you have given. What was the example? Two believers, they have a fight between themselves, some kind of enmity or a property dispute or some family dispute. One of them kills the other. The imam is saying that no, this verse which promises eternal punishment does not apply to this person. So the narrator, the Rawi, is surprised. So he said, okay, then who does it apply to? Imam answers, it applies to a person who kills a believer because he is a believer, because of his faith, because he is a Muslim, for example, because of his deen. Okay, so see, so there are details about this verse of the Quran which I don't know. Yes, in this verse of the Quran, eternal punishment is promised. And this eternal punishment is haq, it's truth. But there can be details which I don't know. And in these details have been described to some extent in our narrations, the Ahlul Bayt have given the details. So conclusion is that it's not the case that if one person murders a believer, he's going to face eternal punishment. No. If someone kills a believer because of his religion, because he's following this religion, in other words, he's killing him because he hates Islam, he hates his being on the right path, because of his belief, he kills him. Yes, for such a person, for such an oppressor, hellfire is promised if he does not repent. Okay, so with this, I come to the end of this session. Okay. I thank you for your time and patience. I know these sessions are rather long, and I really appreciate your patience for being with me. I know it can be difficult. It's night time in most places where you're listening. It's early morning here in the holy city of Qom. Okay, so I just have 8 minutes. Okay, so in the last session, we had one question about why I become a normal human being and the imams, they become the imams. They get the distinction. They get the distinction of becoming masoom. Unfortunately, it would take me at least 15 minutes to explain that, and I was hoping that I'll finish early today and cover that part. So again, I apologize to the brother. Inshallah, I'll definitely cover this in the next session. So in my next session, I just have 2 doubts to cover. I've deliberately kept it that way so that I don't have to cover a lot. Inshallah, I'll definitely answer that question because I have to explain it. There's details which I can't explain here. Okay, there are just few questions that were asked. I'm just going to answer them. I'm just going to answer them quickly because I don't have much time. Okay, so one of the questions was this. Okay, so one of the questions that I shortly answered, that what about those people born in a different faith? Okay, so I answered it that eventually what matters is that how much efforts they took. Some more details I'll cover in my next session. Okay, the other question which one of the sisters asked is, how do we know if the test we are facing is a test or because of sins? And this is a very important question, and the answer to this is that we will never know. Okay, so, and it has been deliberately kept like this, that you will face a test, you will face a difficulty, but you'll never be able to know for sure that why this happened. Okay, unless, for example, a ma'asum comes and tells you, and which is not going to happen, right? I mean, we don't have access to, unfortunately, the imam of our time. Only a ma'asum, a person who's directly connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can tell you that why exactly this thing happened. Any non-ma'asum cannot tell you why this happened. Okay, so it can be any reason. It can be a sin maybe I committed, this is to compensate for this sin. Or no, it's not because of any sin I committed. It's there to make me stronger. It's there to teach me something. It's there to inculcate a new quality in me. Or no, it's just there to wake me up. It's just going to shake me up like those speed breakers, so I don't fall asleep. Okay. And the good thing is about this thing, and the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not tell us many things, and this is one of the things that he's not going to tell me, that why exactly this test has come, is because it doesn't matter why this test has come. What matters is that how you react to this test and this difficulty. So whatever be the reason, it doesn't matter. It's irrelevant why this test has come, the reason behind it. Yes, there was a reason. I don't know, and I don't need to know. It's irrelevant. Why? Because what now matters is how do I react to this situation? So how do I face this test? And how do we face the test? I do my duty at that particular point of time. I face a difficulty. I have a duty to do. I do that duty. If I have a disease, I go and try to fight the disease. I go to the doctor. I try to get it cured. Okay? And during the time that I'm feeling sick, I don't complain too much. I try to remain happy. I try to look at the positive. I try to be patient. So what is important is to do the duty when we face these tests. Okay. There's another comment from one of the brothers. A small action that bring defect to the baby into womb affect him in this dunya. Okay, so yes, I agree with you that every realm, what happens in every realm affects the next realm. So what happens in the womb affects the dunya. What happens in the dunya affects the akhirah, the hereafter. But there is a difference. What happens in dunya is what we do through our free will. So its result in the hereafter is the result of our own actions, and we are responsible for it. And whatever we have produced for ourselves through our actions, either goodness or evil, that we'll face and we'll be responsible for it. But what happens in the womb is not in the control of the baby. Okay. And it's very clear. It's not something. So if something happens in the womb of the mother and because of that thing, a defects come into picture, okay, certainly it's not the fault of the baby. And in most cases, even it's not even the fault of the mother. Okay. Why do these things happen? We tried to discuss this in our previous sessions. Natural calamities and defects. Okay, so if you just remember that discussion, if you mention this point as a question, then the answer goes back to this, that same question, that why do we have natural defects? Okay, something happens in the womb of the mother and it affects that person. Okay, so to know the answer, we have to go through those same six steps that were mentioned. That I'm just going to mention the step six, that yes, this baby will be born with defect and there could have been multiple causes. Okay. And let us say that there were no voluntary causes involved. Okay. The mother and father did everything right. They did everything they should have done. Yet this defect came into existence. It is because of the limitations of this material world. These limitations can occur, but this doesn't mean that this person will be deprived of spiritual pleasure and spiritual closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, his responsibility will be less. For example, he's born blind, his responsibility will be less, his accounting will be easier, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate him, he'll look at him with mercy, he'll provide ease for him in this world. Even if he faces difficulties, it will be a source of his getting higher stations in the hereafter. In summary, he's not going to lose out because of this defect. Yes, it's going to affect him in his material world, but doesn't mean that he's going to lose out and he can't reach perfection. No, who knows? And these are very important things, right? Who knows? Maybe the journey of that blind person who faced so many difficulties in his life, he has such a station near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we can't even imagine. Who knows? Can we say that his station will be lower than me or the lower the people who have eyes? Really, I don't know. I don't know how his spiritual journey is taking place. Okay. Whatever guidance he received, how much efforts he took, based on that, there will not be even slightest of injustice. Okay, let me read this last question. Okay. So in the Holy Quran, indeed, they who disbelieved among the people of the scriptures and the policies will be in the fire of hell, abiding eternal therein. Those are the worst of the creatures. Okay. Okay, so this is a question. Okay, so the answer is, what do you mean? Okay, so let me put it this way. Details, inshallah, I'll cover in my next session, because this is exactly what is going to come. That, okay, so remember this, in my next session, I'm going to start with this question, that what happens to the good deeds of disbelievers and what happens to their felicity in the hereafter? So this is the question which we are going to cover, and this verse is exactly related to that. The answer to this question is that the answer to this question is no. Does this include all of them? The answer is no. Anyone who is apparently a mushrik, polytheist, or a kafir, okay, in the fiqhi terminology, okay, so in our jurisprudence and in our fiqh, we describe some people as mushrik. For example, everyone who worships an idol is a mushrik. Or who says that there are partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a mushrik. Okay. And kafir also has a definition which we'll cover next time. So if you mean this definition of a polytheist and disbeliever, which we have in our jurisprudence in the books of Ahkam, where the Maraji have given their fatawa, the answer is no. That they're not all of them are sentenced to hell eternally. Okay. Then the question is, okay, then what is this verse talking about? Okay. This verse is talking about a group of people, the same things I mentioned, who have disfigured their soul in a manner that now they can't turn back. Okay. And who are the people who will be saved from amongst them? What happens to the good deeds they do? How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deal with these people in the hereafter? Inshallah, I'll cover in the next session. But the answer right now, a short answer to this question, is no. Why I'm saying no, that not all of them will go to the hellfire eternally. Why? Because the formula based on which people are sent to either heaven or hell or even in the hell for eternally is very complicated. We shouldn't think it's like 2 plus 2, 4. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just going to push everyone. Okay, all of you just go there. No, it's not like that. His accounting is very precise and so many factors are going to come into picture. And inshallah, I'll discuss this in detail in my next session. In fact, next session, I only have 2 questions to answer. My second question is hardly going to take me 10 minutes, or maybe 15 minutes. And I'm going to spend good 30 minutes or even maybe 40 minutes on this aspect or this question, that what happens to the good deeds of disbelievers and what happens to their felicity, their end in the hereafter, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to judge them. He's a just Lord. Okay. The short answer is that the formula is very complicated and you cannot derive judgment by just looking at one verse of the Holy Quran. No, you have to look at all the verses of the Quran. You have to look at the tafsir of this verse. You have to go into the details of this particular verse and other verses which talk about this. And you also have to refer to the narration. So it's not an easy task. So what is suggested and what is logical is that we refer to the scholars who have gone through these verses of the Quran. And by looking at all the verses of the Quran and the narrations that are under these verses and the tafsir of these verses, they give us a summarized version of what happens in this particular issue. And inshallah, at the end of my next session, I'll also recommend some books by some of our senior scholars on this topic. And this is what we need, that we should be referring to our ulama, our scholars who have spent 20, 30 years of their life to understand intricacies of Islam, the depth of Islam, the different details it had, the different details Islam has. Inshallah, in this manner, we'll be able to benefit. Thank you for your time. Again, I have exceeded my time, but I have no choice. There's many things to cover and so little time, but I thank you for your patience. And I hope these sessions will be beneficial for you. Think about these things. These are not some things which I'm telling you and you have to accept because I'm saying them. No, think about these things. Islam is a religion which encourages us to think, to use our intellect. And if we understand, if I understand this, then I understand it, right? Then no one can raise a doubt. But I don't understand it. If I don't take efforts to understand it, then I don't understand it. Okay? And the doubts and questions will remain. So every single person has to reach his own conclusion. It's not something which can be enforced or forced on someone. Again, thank you for your time and I apologize for exceeding the time by 5 minutes. Inshallah, I leave you with this hope that I'll see you next week, inshallah, in our last session. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.